Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this week's Link for Growth TV show. It's Friday the 30th of September, and as usual, you can get in touch with us via Twitter at L4G SW Herts. That's at L4G SW Herts via Twitter. We look forward to any comments you may have or any news items you want us to cover. We really do have an absolutely full programme this week, with Chris doing two interviews and making an emergency delivery of lemon drizzle off in between them as well. So it's going to be a busy time for Chris on the road as well. Hopefully he'll get there everywhere in good time. In the meantime, we're going to talk about the Abbey Flyer and the news that appeared in the Watford Observer website a bit later on. That's the second interview of the day. But the first interview of the day is Chris is going to talk to Rachel Brett, who's going to be hosting a new Link for Drinks event in Abbot Strangley at the Royal Oak starting on Tuesday. Chris, you've got Rachel with you.
Yeah, hi Diane. Yeah, can you hear me all right?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so yeah, I'm sitting here in the Royal Oak in the garden, and for 30th of September, you could be forgiven for thinking it's still summer, but it's all very pleasant here, and I'm sat with Rachel. I'm going to put Rachel on screen now so that you can see her, see who I'm talking to, as it were. Hang on a sec, we're not there yet, but can you see Rachel now?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so Rachel, you're part of the duo that's going to be doing the Link for Drinks here on Tuesday. So it's you and who's the other lady?
The other lady is Marina Quinn.
Right, okay. She's got a house full of kids this afternoon, which
that's
is why
right.
she can't be here. Mm-hmm. So you've been involved with Link for Growth for a while now, actually, a year or two.
So.
Basically, I popped a question on to the Abbots Langley Matters and Kings Langley Matters Facebook pages, asking if people had any idea of anywhere where we could get the people in the local community together and out of their houses. Mm-hmm. And it was the people responded to it, and there were, I don't know how many responses, 10, 15 responses. And then the next question, of course, was who wants to get involved? And actually, I know you've travelled all around the district, I think for a district, but we've never had anything here, have we?
No, we haven't. And it's walking distance from home.
Brilliant. So for you to get here today, you literally just had to get a pair of shoes and walk down here?
Yes.
Fantastic. And you work from home anyway?
Yes.
So that's convenient. So tell us about Tuesday then. What's happening? We've got a drinks evening.
We have a drinks evening. It's going to be here at the Royal Oak. It starts at 7:30.
Yep.
And basically it's an opportunity to mix people from the community, from all walks of life, whether you're a business, whether you've got a community project going on, to just for everyone to get to know each other once a month, to understand what they can do to help each other out.
So this is going to be a crusade for this part of the world, because I actually grew up in Leavesden, and actually Abbots Langley is my kind of old stomping ground, as it were. And in fact, the last time I was in the Royal Oak, except for when we met a few weeks ago, was when I was on a pub crawl back in my younger days. And I think this was halfway round, and I don't remember a lot about it, to be fair. But so we've got Leavesden probably going to come on stream at some point, and also Kings Langley with a bit of luck. So this is the first one. So it's really important that we get this off to a flying start.
It is, and the nice thing is it's equidistant between the two. So it gives an opportunity for everyone from that area to get to know each other. And then when they feel more confident, to be able to set up in those areas as well.
But fabulous.
We'll see how we go.
Yeah, so and actually Abbots Langley's got loads of little coffee shops as well. So we've got potential to take something into the morning or the afternoon as well.
Yes,
here.
We do. We have two or three little coffee shops actually. Bread shops and coffee shops and all sorts of things. So
So if anybody's watching and they've not been to Abbots Langley for a while, it really is. I mean, when I was a kid, I mean, Sheffield's was still here. That's
it's
still here. But a lot of the other shops, I mean, you know, I used to have my hair cut in Abbots, and then I think it was like one of those curio shops selling all sorts of odds and sods.
That's a hair shop again.
That's back to being a hair shop now. So you know, they're, and it's a really interesting little village, actually. And I think it's quite, actually, is it quite close knit?
It is quite close knit. A lot of stuff goes on here, lots and lots of things that you can go and go for the Henderson Hall. They always have a coffee morning on a Friday morning. They've got things going on in the local Abbots Langley Community Centre as well. There's lots of things going on, and it's quite nice.
And it's got a very old church here, and I know that because I got married in it.
I haven't been to the old church.
The St. Lawrence's Church up here. So, yeah, lovely church. So, if you want to look at a bit of character, come up here early. Come up here at 6:30 on Tuesday or something like that, and then actually have a little look around before we start at half seven, isn't it?
It's 7:30, yes.
And people can expect some fun, a bit of a laugh, find out a little bit about what's going on.
Yes, and what we can offer and see what people want. It's very much what people want to
Fabulous stuff. All right, Diane, have you got any questions for Rachel?
Where is the Royal Oak exactly in Abbots, for those who don't know?
So where is the Royal Oak in Abbots? Right, okay. So it depends in which direction you're coming from, Diane. If you're coming from, if you like, Watford and the south Kings Langley sort of direction, you're coming up, what's the name of that road that comes up past here, what's that name of that
road? Gallows Hill Road.
Was it
Gallows Hill?
If you're coming up Gallows Hill, when you get to the top of the hill before you hit the actual high street, it's on the right hand side, and it is set back in some very delightful grounds, so it's not actually on the road. You can just about see it, but it is set back. It's opposite the park, yeah. Coming from the other direction, from Bedmond or from Leavesden, you have to go through the town, through the village, and then as you're going out of the village on the same road, it's on the left-hand side as you opposite the park again. Won't have changed. It's still opposite the park.
So it's kind of opposite the cricket ground.
Yeah, around that sort of area, yeah.
Yeah, okay, great. Just a general sort of thing.
And there is parking here, and on Tuesday it should be all right, but it's tight. It is tight, but you can don't park it under the trees or anything, but I'm sure there's plenty of parking on the road.
Okay, well, I remember Abbots Langley as well, and I used to go to the sweet shop there occasionally when I was very little, on the corner, the bonbon shop, I think it was called.
It'd be delightful to see you again, Diane.
And my parents were also married in St. Lawrence's Church, so I have strong connections with the area. Anyway,
Good connections with Abbots then. Everyone seems to have got married there.
Exactly. Okay, well, thanks very much, Rachel, and good luck with that event. And Chris, I know you're now off to Brickett Wood via an emergency delivery of lemon drizzle to your mum.
Yeah, well, fortunately, I've got to go past my mum's road to get to Brickett Wood. So it's not out of my way, which is fortunate. And it's a emergency lemon drizzle because I won't be here after tomorrow. I'm off for a few days. So.
Okay, well, that's great. And we'll see you a bit later on in the show when we talk about the Abbey Rail Link.
Yeah, so I've done a little bit of reading about this, and it seems to be a bit of a mess, actually. So hopefully we'll be able to shed some light on it.
Exactly, it's quite an involved and complicated issue. So we look forward to you meeting Robin White, who's the membership secretary of the Abbey Flyer Users Group, later on in the show.
Absolutely. Okay. Enjoy the show until I'm back.
Will do. Thanks, Chris.
Bye.
Bye. Drive safe. Okay, Neil. Sports intros and stuff like that first. What are the big three subjects you're going to be covering this week?
So we got a report about Watford's game last week against Burnley. Extremely poor performance. We were trying to shed some light on that and giving a preview against tomorrow's game against Bournemouth. Also, we talk about a mixed week for local sports clubs, for both Kings Langley in football, West Herts in hockey, and Valerians in rugby.
Okay. Tanya's not here this week, unfortunately. She's away, so I'm covering some of her news and sharing the details with Catherine. We're going to be talking about Watford Borough Council announced a new recycling scheme. Watford benefits cheats and the council are clamping down. And Hartsmere are going to be checking the electoral roll again. So that's the main news items. And Catherine, what have you got for us this week?
Purple. I have purple, Diane. Lots of purple everywhere. I've also got lots of things going on in Watford High Street. There's a special weekend going on in Watford High Street, which I'll tell you all about that later. And obviously lots of music, shows and all the rest of it going on as well. Plus, of course, our restaurant review, which is rather a nice one this week.
Okay, that sounds really interesting and good. So, the news. Watford Borough Council have announced a new scheme, saying every house in Watford is getting a food caddy, an initial supply of biodegradable liners later this year to make recycling food waste a little bit easier. And as you know, we're quite keen on recycling here at Link for Growth. So the council hope that there will be no more mess and fewer unpleasant smells, as all the food waste that we generate will be safely wrapped up in biodegradable liners. Watford recycles almost 6,000 tonnes of green waste every year, but the councillor responsible, Peter Taylor, who oversees this kind of area of recycling and waste, wants the town to do even better. He says that people in Watford are really committed to recycling, but around a third of the food waste currently ends up in landfill. Food waste in black bins costs us more to get rid of, as well as being bad for the environment. If it goes into the green bins, then it ends up as compost, fueling the food for the future. The new scheme has been rolled out across all houses in the borough. However, if you live in a block of flats or communal housing and would like to take part in the recycling food waste, please contact Viola on 020 3567 6900, and they will be able to assist you. That's Viola on 020 3567 6900. New caddies and biodegradable bin liners will come with instructions on how to use them, delivered by Watford Borough Council's partner Viola. The liners must have a seedling logo on them. That logo means they can be composted according to the European standards. Matt Green, senior contracts manager for Viola, says, "I'm delighted that we are now able to accept the biodegradable caddy liners in the green lidded bins. These biodegradable liners make it so much easier to recycle food waste. I really hope we'll be seeing a big reduction in the amount of food that ends up in landfill. The simplest way to keep food waste out of landfill is to eat more of the food we buy. The Love Food, Hate Waste campaign says the average family could save about £700 a year simply by throwing less food away. Over 350,000 tonnes of bread, for example, is binned in the UK each year." So that's quite a big initiative that Watford Council are launching there. Neil, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Because I know that the coffee shop you own, Reason, is the first one in Watford to have recyclable takeaway coffee cups, isn't it?
Yes. So there was a story hit the headlines a month or so ago, and everyone was really shocked to find out that the cups, paper cups we're using, aren't recyclable because they have a oil-based lining. And there was a big TV campaign about it. And we've managed to persuade our coffee supplier to get some in. So there's no reason everyone out there couldn't have them. They weren't much more expensive than the normal cups. So yes, we're the first, but hopefully others will take up the challenge to get them as well, because there's something like 5 million coffee cups a day going into landfill. And the ones I've got are also made with 100% renewable materials as well. So if your coffee shop doesn't have compostable and renewable green cups, ask them to get them in. Ask them to speak to their supplier.
Okay, thank you, Neil. Continuing the environmental theme, just a quick reminder, Three Rivers District Council, we did announce this earlier on in the series when they announced the actual event. Just a quick reminder, this Thursday, Three Rivers District Council are offering free training support to help cut costs and save energy for local businesses. So if you are a local business in the Three Rivers District Council area, then you can pop along to a free workshop held between 9:30 and 11:30 at Three Rivers District Council House in Rickmansworth, where you can get details on how you can cut your energy bills and get support for putting extra insulation into your office building or your workspace building. There are various grants available, and this is a run in conjunction with the energy, the Green Business Fund, who are jointly running it with Three Rivers District Council. So that's this Thursday between 9:30 and 11:30. Tickets are still available, apparently.
I was just going to jump back just very briefly, Diane, just to the bin liner things that are going to be delivered by Watford Council. I should be writing to them and finding this out possibly for next week. Two things that sort of spring to mind for me. First is these new caddies, they're going to be in addition to our green bins, or are they instead of? I'm not sure. Because for those who already recycle food waste and everything, it all goes in the green bin. So are we now putting things in the recyclable bin liners instead of that or as well? I'm not sure. I also don't know whether, yes, they're providing these specific recyclable bin liners to start with. Are they going to continue to supply them to all residents, or will residents have to actually buy them? So I think there are two things we need to clarify for next week, perhaps.
I think we do. Website press release doesn't go into any more details beyond what I've given. So
yeah, I know, I read it. So I think we'll have to. I'll write to them on the email that they've given there, and see if we can just clarify those details. Otherwise, right, we'd end up quite costly for some residents to be buying those in addition to everything else.
Okay, well, and it doesn't really apply to me because I live in a flat.
Well, this is it. Yes, there's other things for people in flats as well, isn't there? But the details are on the council website, aren't they?
Yes, Watford Borough Council website matters. Okay, Watford Borough Council are getting tough on benefit cheats. A woman who wrongly claimed nearly £43,000 of benefits must now pay nearly £60,000 after not returning a single penny since Watford Borough Council successfully prosecuted last year. A Watford resident, of Rose Gardens, and her daughter of Chesham Way had illegally claimed more than £185,000 between them. The pair had more than £260,000 hidden away in 100 different accounts, but continued claiming benefits for many years. The First Lady refused to pay her fine of £66.16, and so this is. So she was handed an 18-month suspended sentence in April last year. However, after successful confiscation proceedings, she's been ordered to pay £59,664 to the two organisations by Monday next week. Otherwise, she'll be sent to prison for 18 months. Elected Mayor Dorothy Thornhill said this case is a good example of lengths a few people go to in order to try and cheat the system for their own advantage. It also shows how Watford Borough Council will crack down and benefit fraud whenever we find it. We have a dedicated team of investigators devoted to catching and exposing benefit cheats. We will not let benefit cheats slip off our radar once caught. This is public money that is intended to support services and those in real need. Failing to pay up immediately has already cost this person around £17,000, and I hope a punishment is a warning to anyone else who considers cheating the system.
Also, I think it's important to note that people like this give other benefit claimants a bad name, because press gets hold of it, they blow it up out of all proportion and say, oh, look, all benefit people are cheats and all the rest of it, and we should cut benefits and blah, blah, blah. Whereas actually there's an awful lot of people that genuinely need it. And people like this lady and her daughter, perhaps, you know, they could have thought a little more selflessly about it and thought, well, actually they're denying people who really need that money. It's sad.
Catherine, Watford Bandstand.
Yes.
We have news.
We do. Yes, it's back. Well, Chris was there the other day, wasn't he? Showing us the bandstand in all its glory. You can now book the bandstand for your own events. Opened up throughout the whole year, community groups can book the bandstand, so local people can put on their own entertainment in the centre of the park. If you're looking for space to perform, the bandstand might suit you. You can apply via email on Casterbury@watford.gov.uk. Tell them what your plans are, what you'd like to use the bandstand for, and obviously when you'd like to use it. Possibly an idea of numbers might be a good idea as well. Using the bandstand will usually be free, unless you're planning to make money out of your event, in which case there's forms and things you need to fill in. But so yeah, I think it's a fabulous idea. The councillors have said we're keen for Watford to use the bandstand, help people to feel part of their community, and the bandstand can play a big part in this. It's a beautiful space where people meet up, whether for a fundraising event like a teddy bear's picnic, or to offer a free concert to passers-by. I know that one of the ecumenical faith groups in the town always held an annual bandstand service. It was usually in the summer when it was outside the town hall. So things like that can still happen as well. So, fabulous idea. Really look forward to that.
Okay. Now, the next piece of news we're going to talk about is the British Masters Golf Tournament at the Grove. Now, we're not going to talk about the actual golf itself, because that's something Neal will be covering on next week's show. But there is news of temporary road closures and parking or stopping restrictions and a change in speed limits in the area to cater for the event. And details are quite long and detailed, but it is the highlights, as it were, or perhaps the lowlights, depending upon your view, is that the traffic light junction at Langley Bury Lane and Watford Road, which is A41, will be temporarily changed instead of it being a crossroads, into a T-junction. Bridge Road will be closed between Watford and Old Mill Lane. Closures on this road will be between 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. from Wednesday the 12th to Sunday the 16th of October. Grosvenor Lane between the junctions with Hempstead Road and Fir Tree Hill will also be closed. Access to residential properties off the Hempstead Road will be retained during the period that this temporary road closure is in force. On top of that, it's a whole host of no stopping or no parking temporary clearway orders in force, and there is also going to be a change in some of the speed limits in the area, all to cope with the projected increase in traffic. And we'll put a link up on the site afterwards about the road closures and changes, but suffice to say they're quite detailed and they are posted on both Watford and Three Rivers District Council websites.
What are the dates for that, Diane?
Well, the actual golf tournament starts on Thursday the 13th and goes through to Sunday the 16th, but the dates of the road closures start on the 12th of October, which is the Wednesday, which I presume is the practice day or something like that. Mm. And Neal will be giving us the lowdown as to who he thinks is going to win and everything next week, won't you, Neal?
I might have to leave that information with you around next week, but okay. I will give you a heads up. The closure on the Wednesday will, because they have a celebrity in practice day on the day before all these big tournaments. So effectively, if you want to go down and see some golf, Wednesday would be a really good day to do it. Although it won't be the actual tournament, they'll all be there and you should have quite easy access to the course.
Yeah, that's Wednesday week, that is. So.
Yes.
Yeah. Great. Okay. So that's that. The Metropolitan Line extension, they've changed date for the community liaison group in Three Rivers. Events now take place on Wednesday, the 5th of October, and this is a change to the date that was previously advertised. The community liaison group is made up of a number of members which represents local residents and stakeholders. The meeting aims to provide a forum through which Metropolitan Line Extension team can provide an update on the project and interested parties can raise matters of interest and concern regarding construction work. The group meets quarterly in public with the local residents and businesses welcome to attend any meeting. Presentations and minutes from the last meeting can be found on the Metropolitan Line Extension webpage, which is accessible through Three Rivers District Council webpage. The October meeting is going to focus on the current utilities work around Baldwin's Lane and Watford Road, and an update on the project and presentation on noise levels. The event is going to take place on Wednesday, the 5th of October, between 6:30 and 8 p.m. And the location is the TS, I presume that's Training Ship Renown, Cassio Bridge, Watford Road, WD3, 3DG. They hope that if you are interested in this project, that you'll go along and hear what they have to say and discuss any issues that you might have with them. Catherine, you're a designer, hence I gave you this.
Well, thank you very much. Anybody that didn't know, I'm a designer. Anybody that's received Richard Harrington's email that gets sent around the town will have seen him wearing a Santa hat. Why, may you ask? Well, indeed, you may ask. It's for a Christmas card competition. He's writing to all the schools in the area and basically saying, design a Christmas card. So this will be something that he sends out to his constituencies, local businesses in the area, possibly even to number 10, who knows. He's running a competition that's over the primary school pupils in the area to find the design for the front cover of his 2016 Christmas card. The winning design will be printed on 2,000 cards sent out and displayed by local people, restaurants, libraries, post offices, schools, businesses, councillors and other members of parliament. They're going to choose the winning pupil online. It's going to be a public vote. The winner will get a framed copy of their card along with a £20 book voucher. Richard will also welcome the family of the winning pupil to Parliament for tea in the new year. Fabulous. The deadline is the 31st of October, so they've got lots of time to get all the cards in, printed and written out. They'll then have the public vote online to choose the favourite with the results out by the 11th of November. There are some guidelines. I'll post this up online. Just a few guidelines. I thought it was interesting. They want to make sure that you reference both Watford and Parliament on the card. Ooh, Christmassy! which I think is interesting. So lots of bold colours. Please draw by hand rather than on computer. There are other guidelines as well, as I'll post this up. But yes, get your thinking caps on. Get designing.
Yes, and can't remember now if you said that the winner will also get afternoon tea for them and their family at Parliament.
Yes. It's very exciting. And there's lots of secret rooms at Parliament, so it's definitely worth a squiz around there, just to go and have a nosy round.
Okay. The last piece of news before we come back to the rail link much later on in the show is that Hartsmere Council are calling on residents to help them get their electoral register right. As the council's annual canvas continues, households across Hartsmere are being asked to check the information that appears about them on the electoral register. They send forms to all 43,000 residential addresses in the borough to make sure the electoral register is up to date and identify any residents who have not registered and to encourage them to do so. Council officers will soon be calling out addresses of those who haven't yet responded, around 12,000 in total, to stress the importance of checking the forms so that everyone is able to have their say at the elections. Joe Bateman, Principal Electoral Services Officer, said that anyone that wants to vote must be registered. To make sure you are able to have your say at elections, we need householders to simply check their form and return it. The job of the canvassers is to call at the addresses where houses haven't yet responded so that we can urge them to check the information and get back to us. Calling door to door also enabled us to answer any questions about the electoral register or voting information or voting that householders may have. It is particularly important that anyone who has moved address recently looks out for the form and checks whether they are registered. Research by the Independent Electoral Commission indicates that across Great Britain, recent homeowners are far less likely to be registered than those who have lived at the same address for a long time. Any resident who has any questions can contact the elections team on 0208 207 7481 or email elections@hartsmere.gov.uk. This canvassing is scheduled to end in the middle of November, so it's going to be going on for quite a few weeks. It's just to make sure they get as many people as they can to vote.
Absolutely. One additional thing I would add to that is if you've got kids at university, then make sure that you sort it out either a proxy or a postal vote for them as well in good time before elections.
Right. Okay. Neil.
Hello.
Hello. I guess we've got to talk about Monday night.
Do we have to? Do we have to relive that? Shambles.
In the interest of impartiality, I mean, we can talk about the highs, which they had the previous weekend when they beat Manchester United. And this is really much a case of the morning after the Lord Mayor's show, wasn't it?
Indeed, it was incredibly disappointing. And what some people feared would happen, that we play one of the so-called lesser teams, because we'd had the hardest start of the season, we'd come away with 7 points and everyone's really happy. Excellent results against West Ham and Manchester United. And right from the get-go, the team were just bullied off the park and weren't up for it. And seeing as we are the team that do that to the big teams, it was really disappointing that there was no reaction from Watford. It was the poorest display by far this season, and we can't have many more like that, that's for sure. Well, we could. Let's hope we don't have many more like that. It was it was no one in particular, unfortunately. You can't say there was a particular person or that. The whole team were a massive letdown. One decent chance the whole game. No closing down in midfield, no passing game. At the back, shocking defending, two crosses. No one jumped to even put a challenge in. Yeah, just a really bad day at the office.
Now, I mean, Troy Deeney said that, was reported as saying anyway, that in WD Sport that they were often bullied by Burnley. Was that the case?
Yeah, they played the high tempo game. They got in our face, did a bit of pushing and shoving, and they were doing that a lot, and they got away with a little bit, but it wasn't blatantly out of order or anything like that. They just played the game that we played against Man United, and we seemed to turn up, even though they said, Mazzari said they weren't underestimating Burnley, we seemed to turn up with a completely different attitude, sat back, let them come at us, and just weren't up for the fight. It was quite worrying to see, really. You're on mute, Diane.
Sorry about that. As I was saying, even Jamie Callagher, is it? The former Liverpool player was saying he feared for Watford if they played like that.
Yeah, I mean, and you have to agree with me if you play like that. I don't presume we will play like that all season. Sorry, isn't a manager who's going to let things lie. So last year, when we started on our bad run and Flores just kept the same team week after week, even though we were having a bad run, I think you can say that Mazzari won't be that manager. He's not shy to drop players, and there's big shouts from the fans and that. Let's see Isaac's success on from the start of the game, and it'd probably be a Galu that was dropped if that was the case. And he did nothing at the weekend to justify staying in the team. So it would be nice actually to see the new lad who's got pace galore and cause a lot of trouble in the 21 minutes he came up against West Ham. It would be good to see him on the pitch.
Okay. Now, this happened last year, didn't it? Watford beat Liverpool 3-1, quite convincingly at home. And then after that, one had the nightmare trips away to Southampton and Swansea, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, that's right. Football is a funny thing. Obviously, you've got your fitness, your work, and I think there's a lot of psychology involved. And maybe it's just got to them. So many big games on the trot, really having to get themselves up. As hard as you try as a manager, you can't control each individual player the way they are mentally set up when they go into a game. And some days I can say from very much lower level, I used to play it. Sometimes you just go out on the pitch and you just couldn't explain why you had a really bad day, even though you thought you were completely prepared. But it's a warning sign that they can't let this happen. And Bournemouth tomorrow, it's a tricky team to play. And it's difficult to call whether we'll turn up or not. It's a home game, but they play a very different style of football from Burnley. They play an attacking, flowing football. So it's going to be a completely different game. Watford have got defensive troubles because Cathcart's injured and Britos is carrying an injury and going to take a fitness test. Jan Mat's already out of the team. So we're going to have a fairly untried defence against a team that likes to play very attacking football and have got excellent forwards such as Callum Wilson. And it's going to be a tough game. I expect tomorrow's game to be an end-to-end stuff. Draw would be a good result after obviously hopefully a win, but after last week's performance a draw would be a good result. We just don't want to lose another game playing badly. We just need to get everyone back together and realising that was a, let's call that an aberration and move on.
Okay, as you said, there are calls to axe Igalo. Do you think he will get axed?
He's not had a great season. he's not had a great season, so and Isaac's success is chomping at the bit, so yeah, I wouldn't be surprised at all. And yeah, I would say that would be a fair enough call by the manager.
Okay, so and as you say, Cathcart's injured, and they got one or two other injuries as well. And last season, they seemed to do really well. Do you think this is all to do with the fact they changed the head of medical the other week?
No, I doubt it. I can't remember his name now. The injury shoulder was a fall, so in the games you can't do anything about that. And we've actually got a ton of new facilities that we didn't have last year, like the cryo cold chamber and that the players worn down in. So I just think it's a run of bad luck, really.
Okay. I mean, a lot of the predictions for tomorrow are a draw. Would you go with that?
Well, in reality, we should be looking for a win, and I hope we do. But obviously last week's result has put a bit of a worrying tinge on the game. I still think we're perfectly capable of winning, but yeah, I'll go for a draw.
Okay. Now, a bit of a mixed week for Kings Langley.
Yes, after losing in the FA Cup previous week, easily beaten 3-0 by Banbury United last week away. 6 minutes in the first half, game was over, 3 goals in 6 minutes by Banbury. And it was 3-0 down to King's Langley. Midweek, they were away to King's Lynn Town, and they raised their game, took the lead 1-0. Unfortunately, couldn't hold on to the lead, and it ended up as a 1-1 draw. But they've got 12 points. They're just below mid-table. Nothing to worry about. Tomorrow, King's Langley are... Where are they next? St Ives at home tomorrow at 3 p.m. St Ives are slightly below them in the league at home, and they're getting good attendances at home now, so they'll be hoping to get a win from that.
Yes, yeah, okay. Now, Phil Arians, we started the season off full of hope, and it seems to have gone off the cracks recently for them.
Yeah, two amazing wins at the beginning of the season for Phil Arians, and two heavy defeats in the last 2 weeks. This last week it was 54-5 loss at Brentwood. A team that are going well in the league, and they look like they're going to be near the top of come the end of the season. And tomorrow, they're away to Electric Garden City, who beat Ruislip 24-8, and are one place above Valerians, also with a 2-2, two wins, two loss record. So they're going to need to get something from this game, otherwise it's going to start to look like a long season.
Yeah, okay. I mean, as Ian Topman said, it's when he came on the show the other week, this is a big step up, isn't it, from the previous season's league?
Yeah, it's a huge step up in quality, much bigger clubs, with a lot bigger squad, stronger players. But they showed me the first two games they can do it. Let's just hope that wasn't just the adrenaline. And they're not going to let these two defeats get to them. I'm sure they won't. It's a long season. But this is a team that are playing about the same level they are, so they need to go out and prove themselves, even if they do lose this. As long as it's not heavily, that will give them some optimism to move forward.
Okay, that's great. West Herts Hockey Club, a bit of unfortunate weekend for them last weekend.
Yes. So both men's and women losing in the first week. This week, the men drew 2-2 with Wapping. Unfortunately, they had the lead but couldn't hold on, and Wapping equalised with 15 minutes to go. The ladies fared quite badly away to Wimbledon, losing 8-2. Wimbledon had quite a few international players in their squad, and they are one of the stronger squads in the league. So they're still working for their first win. The ladies this weekend will be playing Chelmsford. In the NHL East Conference, and the men will be playing. Oh, are the men playing? I haven't got that.
Yes, they are. Let me just double check for you.
I didn't get that.
Okay, no problem. They are playing And first 11 are playing at home on Sunday to Teddington at 2 o'clock. Start.
Okay, thanks for that. Sorry about that. So it's early days again for them. They're both in the top leagues. First time club had two teams in the top, they're both teams in the top league. That's the sport this week.
Okay, well, it isn't actually quite. You wanted to mention rumours about Anthony Joshua.
Indeed, thanks for reminding me. Yes, so the rumours flying around, Anthony Joshua has his date booked for his next fight, but the person who's going to be fighting hasn't been named. And the big rumours flying around everywhere that it's going to be Vladimir Klitschko, and if it is, that's going to be an absolutely ginormous fight with two absolutely ginormous men. But unfortunately, we can't report that as fact at the moment because its promoter has come out and said the deal is far from done. But it does sound like that's who they're trying to get the fight with. So that'll be a huge world title fight for Anthony Joshua against someone who's proven himself to be world class and a world champion himself.
Okay, that's great. That's great. Thank you for that, Neil. And let's hope that you're right. We will no doubt hold you to it.
Thank you. Well, enjoy the rest of the show. I can't hang around for the rest of the show, but I will watch back because it's interesting what's going to happen with the train Abbey Flyer. Very interesting stuff. And I would just say from my point of view, I'd like the studies to be done and whatever is the best carbon footprint option to be taken. I think that's the most important thing right now with the current fight against climate change. So I don't like to follow any dogma on either side. I think I would like to see, rather than proposals being chucked around, proper studies done, and I would say let's follow that, and I would guess that would be a light railway, but we'll see.
Okay, that's great. Chris, thank you for that, Neil.
Yes,
hi, Chris.
Yes. Hi, Diane, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay, so the signal's not awesome down here, so we'll do our best.
Okay, that's great, because it is an important piece that we're going to be talking about. A couple of years ago there was a review about the Abbey Flyer and whether or not it should continue, and for those who don't know, the Abbey Flyer is the rail link that runs between Watford and St Albans Abbey station. It's a little branch line, but it's a branch line that gets used quite a lot for weekends and also commuters and people like that, as they get the trains into London as they're coming from North Watford. Everyone thought that was going to save the Abbey Flyer. But on the front page of this week's Observer, on their website that is, there's a new article saying that the proposal is to bring back a busway, which was what they was originally proposed two years ago and not gone forward. But they've kind of reintroduced this proposal again as part of a scheme that ARAP have undertaken on behalf of Herts County Council to build a new east-west links around Hertfordshire, which has been identified as a major shortfall. Obviously, we wanted to get some views and facts on this, and you're with Robin White, who's the Membership Secretary of the Abbey Flyer Users Group.
Yeah, that's correct. And so,
pleased to see you. Very pleased to speak to you.
Now, clearly, you're very involved in the Abbey Flyer and the users group. Tell us what's going on.
What has happened is we have only just learnt, like last Friday, that an idea which was mooted a year ago, but in fact is older than that, because they were thinking about this about 15 years ago. But anyway, it was seriously mooted a year ago. We had several meetings and several discussions and collected signatures, and everybody that we spoke to was against the idea, and it's now been revived despite the fact that everybody was against it.
This idea
is to rip up a railway line that has been there for 150 years and links to the main line and replace it with a guided busway. And as far as we can make out, we haven't had direct discussions this time round. As far as we can make out, the idea is that the buses will come off the guided busway and will then mingle with the traffic in Watford and St Albans. Now, I suggest that it's patently obvious that that is a very bad idea, because all it's going to do is add to the congestion. It's not going to be bus rapid transit, it's going to be bus slow transit, because as soon as it mingles with, it's going to add to the traffic, and it's going to get stuck in the traffic unless they're going to carve out a completely new route, which, I mean, there is of course the old line to Hatfield, which is now the Alban Way, a cycleway, but it would be conceivable to think of reopening that as a rail line. The best proposal, which came up about 5 years ago and was abandoned, was they were going to convert the thing to the light rail, in other words a tramway, and we were in favour of that. And a tramway could always be extended at either end into ordinary road systems or across land in a much easier way than heavy rail. But this itself was abandoned. That was a serious scheme, and we were in favour of that. But this was abandoned, we understood, because they would have to take responsibility for the bridges, which are the same age as the railway line, 150 years old, some of them. And, of course, while it's a heavy rail line, that responsibility rests with Network Rail. But if the County Council took it over and sponsored a tramway, they would have had to take the responsibility of the bridges, which obviously was an open-ended liability. That is our understanding as to why that scheme was dropped. But the point that we would say to be positive is that we have been on all the time for saying that a relatively small amount of expenditure on the line as it is, most noticeably to replace the passing loop, which used to be at Bricketwood until the 1960s, loops so that two trains could pass, you could immediately double the frequency of the train, and that coupled with a later evening service, because it stops in the middle of the evening, which is all wrong, but that coupled with a later evening service would mean loads more people would use it. I mean, not twice as many people, but loads more people, because it would be frequent, reliable, and run late enough that you could get back from London.
So what's the frequency that it runs now?
Well, the maximum frequency that it can run with the present equipment on the present line is 45 minutes.
Okay.
And that, for a journey that is only 16, 17 minutes end to end, that is too slow.
Yeah.
It's too infrequent, and not, I mean, it's not true to say that not many people used it. Actually, a lot of people used it, and the use has been on the increase, but it's nothing like the amount of people that would use it, and it would take traffic off the road, because lots of people drive to Watford Junction or drive to St Albans who would then be able to use the train if they knew that there was a frequent, reliable link.
I mean, to be absolutely honest, driving to St Albans or driving to Watford, that is the worst journey ever.
Yes. And I mean, this is the point. But why rip it up? I mean, the point is, once a rail line goes, it's gone forever. It's been proved other places around the country. And if you lose a rail line, you've lost it forever. You've lost the possibility in the future of it linking into the rail system. I mean, it does link into the rail system, but you've lost the possibility of through trains to Euston, which they say they can't do at the moment for technical reasons, but it's conceivably possible in the future that we could have through trains to Euston. There is also the possibility, depending what happens, you know about the rail freight proposal, do you?
No, well, personally, no.
Well, it's a whole other chapter, but there is supposed to be, going ahead, a rail freight interchange, in other words, freight from lorries onto the trains at Radlett, not at Radlett station, but at what was Radlett airfield. And, I mean, people are worried about that because it'll be a lot of lorry congestion. But there are various situations where it might be useful, if this remains a rail line, the two lines are only about half a mile apart. And in fact, going back in history, when the main line was built, they used this line to convey building materials.
Right.
So there was temporarily a link. So it just means to say, well, you lose it forever. Now, the buses are going to be diesel, so they're going to be polluting. I mean, we're supposed to be moving away from diesel, aren't we? The buses are going to be diesel. We've got electric traction at the moment. It was electrified in the mid-80s, so it's relatively clean. I mean, obviously the energy is generated somewhere, but it's clean at the point of use. There's
no
there's no pollution with electric trains. It's reasonably reliable, but as I say, if it ran later, which is what we've been on about, they are. We have secured one later service. It's still not late enough. But we have secured one later service, which will be introduced in December with the next timetable change, and that will mean it's a little bit easier to get back from London, but still not late enough. But the main thing is the passing loop, which, I mean, they've quoted a figure of £90 million for this, you know, this guided bus. Well, less than a tenth of that would have bought the passing loop, and okay, you've then got to run the extra train, so that's an operating.
I mean, my view is quite simple. Like you said, once you turn into a bus route, you can switch it off. You can switch it off any time you like.
Oh, yes. I mean, people don't like buses, actually. They regard the buses as the lowest of the low. I mean, seriously, you know. I mean, you know, I'm of an older generation, but I mean, it's basically the very young. It's the young, the poor and the old that ride buses. The old because we get bus passes. The young because they can't afford it, and the poor for the same reason.
Yeah.
I mean, buses are slow, they get held up with traffic. I mean, the idea of an extra bus service up Holywell Hill in St Albans, I mean, it doesn't bear thinking about, because the, you know, it can take 10 minutes, a quarter of an hour sometimes to get from the top to the bottom of St Albans.
Yeah.
And Watford likewise. I mean, the congestion round Watford Junction Station, even when
horrible.
There's no, you know, you just say, think again. Think again, you know, go back to the drawing board. Obviously, this is supposed to have been done by consultants, but it depends what brief they were given. You know, they were probably just told to save money.
Well, what can people do to help? To help? I mean, I can see if they think there.
Yes, if you go on this website.
Yeah.
What I've been saying probably far more succinctly than I've just done.
Yeah.
There is a petition you can sign, and it, what will happen is it's a signature added to a petition, and it also generates a letter to the County Council, because they've asked for responses by mid-December, which is actually a very short space of time.
Right.
But anybody that goes onto that website, they will get, they will get the opportunity to add their signature, and that will be two things, as I say. It will be a petition, and it will be a further letter generated. They can see the text of the letter, they can see what they're signing, they can see all the argument laid out. We have an absolutely incredible whiz kid, our chairman, by the name of David Horton. He is a railway professional. Unfortunately, he no longer lives in the district, but he's the most active and knowledgeable person we've got. I mean, I'm really just acting as a spokesman today.
Okay.
But it's all carefully laid out on the website. They can read it for themselves, but literally just click on, add their signature.
An opportunity for people power right here.
Absolutely. But I mean, we got several hundreds last year, and we thought they'd taken notice, but they haven't. So, I mean, we need thousands this time. So it's a case of tell your friends, this is on YouTube.
Yeah.
Share it. Share it with as many people as you can. Share it. I would say even people who might not themselves very often use the train, or might use that because they don't live in the right place, that will help to take cars off the roads.
That's definitely worth fighting for.
That's the thing. Right. And it's not just, when I say, if you say it's a community link, it makes it sound all soft and pink and fluffy. This is the trouble. But it's not just that, but it's an asset. It's a public asset, and it's something that's been there, as I say, for 150 years, but you could scrap it in, and then you've lost it forever. And it, options that there could be in the future for faster service for connecting to Euston. They say they can't do that at the moment because of congestion on the main line, but that might change. The whole thing might change. And as I say, possible link at the other end. I mean, but the possibility exists to link up with the main line at the other end, just a very little bit of land in between.
Good stuff. So, Diane, any questions that I haven't covered that you'd like to ask?
I was just wondering if Robin had any views on the proposed redevelopment around Watford Junction that we talked about last week, and how they might affect the plans to keep the rail link as a rail link, or turn it into a light railway, or turn it into a busway.
Haven't we covered that already about that?
Well, I just wanted to make sure that everyone understood.
Well, I mean, you know, you're what are the timescales they've got in terms of...
I've absolutely no idea. I mean, they will probably say, because we are attacking them with all guns blazing, even more than last year, they will probably say, oh, well, it's only for the future, it's our vision for the, you know... I thought it was mystics and saints that had visions. I don't really see that we pay our council officers to have visions for the future. What we want is, you know, the right stuff. Now probably say, oh well, it's not going to happen right away, but I mean, you bet your boots, if we don't
keep chipping
this,
away,
if we don't oppose this, they'll suddenly, you know, they'll get hold of some money somewhere, they'll make a start. And the trouble is, if they make a start, I mean, there is history of this. There's the Cambridge St Ives line. I mean, that's been going for quite some time.
Right.
I haven't got the figures to hand, but by all accounts it was overrun, over budget, it's underused, it's very costly. And, I mean, the other thing I didn't say, actually, apart from the business of diesel traction rather than electric, the other thing is all the road on the countryside, it's effectively like building another road. And the Cambridge St Ives one is cracking already, and it will crack. I mean, you know, if you lay a concrete path, eventually the frost gets in and it cracks. Unless you make it sort of 9 feet thick.
So, any idea if the tram thing could come back on the table?
The most sensible thing, and I say this to the people concerned, if they happen to get sight of this, the most sensible thing would be to sensibly revisit the light rail. Let's call it light rail.
Light rail, yeah.
Because there are options. Sensibly revisit the light rail option and look at reopening the Hatfield line. It would mean that the cycle route would have to be rerouted somewhere. I mean, the cyclists would all be up in arms and they'd all be in their tight light costumes waving banners, you know, fair enough. But I mean, way would between quickly, you know, they call it rapid, they want rapid transit. And I mean, trams are rapid once they get out of the city, they're rapidly on to the next place, and that would provide rapid transit between St Albans and Hatfield, which is what they want. I mean, I think ideally they want to take it further east to sort of Hartford and Ware and that sort of thing. I mean, they'd have to plough a new furrow for that. There isn't a track existing. At least I don't know that there is one. There might be. You never know, actually. There are lots of old, disused... I mean, they're not rail tracks anymore, disused corridors.
Yeah.
They might be able to... But certainly that would be a possibility, because the link is... Most of the link is there. Most of the link is there. But we would say revisit the light rail option. And look at it seriously. Look at why it was abandoned last time, and you know, see what development can be made. Because I mean, this business of the bridges. I mean, they'd be faced that with the busway anyway.
Mm.
They'd face that, they'd have to readopt the bridges, and it would. I mean, if it was a problem with light rail, it'd be a problem with the busway.
So, absolutely.
You know.
All right. Are we okay, Diane? Is that enough for you down there?
That's really good. Well, no doubt I'll come back and perhaps in December time when we know the results of the consultation and maybe speak to Robin again then and get some more news and views as to what's happening.
Fabulous. Okay. All right. I will return the focus back to the studio then.
Okay. Thank you. Bye, Chris.
Thanks. Bye.
So what happens? Does this get edited?
I was just going to say, we can post up the link that Robin was talking about for the petition for anybody that's interested. I actually posted the information about, you know, the breaking news from this morning on Facebook this morning, and there was a whole discussion and lots of interesting views going on there as well. So do join in discussions about it. I would just say the Abbey line, or Abbey Flyer as it used to be called, is literally about 100 yards from my house. We use it all the time. A lot of people along the line and beyond use it a lot. But the one failing thing about it is that it doesn't run frequently enough. And certainly in terms of the last train's about 10 o'clock in the evening, which is not late at all, you know. I remember there was a big festival in St Albans not long ago, and so many people would have been able to leave their cars at home if at the train to run a bit later than 10 o'clock. Either you've got to get an early train back and miss the end of something, or you drive. So and I was just going to mention, Robbie mentioned about, oh, of course, you know, if it is a light railway or the existing railway, then cyclists wouldn't be able to make use of, you know, the new busway idea. Well, actually, it's easy to take your bike on a train. And so many people do at the moment, you know, which you can't do with a bus. But you know, there's so many advantages to it remaining a railway. And a light railway tram idea is a good idea. It's also more environmentally friendly. Buses use diesel. That's my theory anyway.
Yes, the cyclist might actually wish to ride their bike on the cycleway, not take it on a tram or a train, but that's another matter.
It is another matter. I mean, essentially it's a railway line. So, you know, it would only be a bonus if there were access for cyclists as well. But as a railway line, it's perfectly functional as it is. And actually, money is better spent on upgrading it rather than... it was interesting, Robin mentioned about the other busways that are in existence at the moment. He mentioned the one in the South West. There's another one in Cambridgeshire. And both of those projects overran cost-wise by at least three times as to what they expected. You're talking millions, billions of pounds, which could actually be, you know, those costs could be a fraction of that if they just upgraded what was there.
Well, what's quite interesting is when you read the report, as I've done for the whole county, there's an awful lot of focus on road congestion and poor east-west road links, which are bad, but there doesn't seem to be that wider consultation on alternative means of getting across. Yes, and of course, Hertfordshire did suffer quite a lot from the beaching cuts back in the 1960s.
It is a problem. It is a problem. It's also concerning that if the busway did go ahead, okay, that stretch would be great, but those buses then have to integrate into town traffic either end. Well, that can't be a good idea. You know, anybody that has anything to do with Watford Junction at 5 o'clock in the afternoon knows that there ain't room for any more buses down there. Yeah. It's, nobody can move down there as it is.
Now, and the whole population around Watford Junction, and I think Chris didn't understand the point I was trying to make, is building up around there with the development we talked about last week.
Exactly.
Just going to put more and more demand on that part of the town.
Exactly. And it would be interesting to find out as well, again, we need to do a bit of research as to whether those plans for Watford Junction include anything to do with, you know, where the Abbey line goes into Watford Junction. It would be interesting to see what, in fact, they have in mind for the end of the line there, if anything. So, yeah, more to come, I'm sure.
I get the feeling this one's going to run and run.
I think so. Well, it has, honestly, Diane, for the last 20 years, hasn't it? You know, we've talked about rail, we talked about scrapping it, we talked about trams, light railways, back to trains again, and now we're on to busway. Hopefully, okay, if the residents get their way, you know, there should be some sensible conversation about scrapping the idea of a busway. Let's work with what we've got, keep it environmentally friendly, get cars off the road, get people onto trains. But we need more of them.
Right, okay. Now, a couple of hospices are talking about wearing purple.
Purple everywhere. Yes, we mentioned these last week, so I'll mention them briefly this week. The Peace Hospice are doing their Wear Purple for the Peace. This is on Friday, the 7th of October, so that's next Friday. Wear something purple, be sponsored, raise money and donate towards the Peace Hospice. Every pound will add up to you and make a huge difference to the local families that this hospice supports. All the details are on our website, and that's the peacehospice.co.uk. You'll find that and all their other events on there as well. So that's next Friday. Also on Friday is Go Purple for the Hospice of St Francis. Purple must be the new autumn colour, I don't know. But they're getting ready for their second annual Go Purple Day, also on Friday the 7th of October. So this isn't just wearing purple, you can have a purple party, dye your hair purple, make purple fairy cupcakes, anything you like. There are fundraising packs you can get online. If you go to stfrancis.org.uk, then you'll find all the details on there under their events page. There is a registration fee. And they do ask for a minimum amount to raise. So do have a look at the details on there. And that's for the Hospice of St. Francis.
Okay, and if you fancy getting warm feet, we talked about this last week, but you can still volunteer for a fire walk.
Indeed, yeah. Again, for the Peace Hospice, this is their fire walk. It's on Thursday, the 27th of October. Could you walk over burning hot coals for the Peace Hospice care? Well, if you can, then get yourself some sponsorship, register online, and go for it. I'm sure it's a bit of a challenge, but something that's very worthwhile, obviously, to support the work of the Peace Hospice in Watford.
Okay, now you have a dog, so this event might be of interest to you.
We have a very small dog, and I have to say, he doesn't walk very far. He gets worn out quite quickly, but it's still a good way to get out and about. Take your dog. This is Helly Hounds Charity Dog Walk. This is supporting the work of the Herts Air Ambulance. Walk those paws for a life-saving cause. Very nice catchphrase. I like the person that came up with that. Sunday the 16th of October, it's at Fairlands Valley Park in Stevenage. You can pre-register for £5 a dog, or you can pay on the day for £7 a dog. It's a 5K walking route. You've got the map online there. If you go to heartsairambulance.uk.com, mm-hmm. you'll find all the details there. Registration opens on the day at 10 o'clock and the walk leaves at 11 o'clock. You can sign up online to receive a registration pack and collect a fabulous free gift on the day. Definitely worth it. There's also a Hound on Holiday photo competition, something else you can get your pooch into. Fabulous idea. As I say, this is Sunday the 16th of October. All the details online.
Okay, that's great. This weekend, there's a new event called the Watford Weekend taking place.
Yeah, this is, well, I've seen it a lot all over the place for the last couple of weeks or so. There is lots and lots going on. Watford is the place to be this weekend. There are discounts all over the place. There's special events going on. Shops, bars, restaurants and gyms are just some of the businesses who joined together to create the Watford Weekender. It's a weekend of special offers, discounts and activities in Watford Town Centre. And this is all over the weekend, so that's Saturday and Sunday. Visitors in the town centre will receive a Watford Weekend brochure. It's quite extensive, lots of glossy pages detailing all the businesses taking part and what their offers are. It includes a family fun day hosted by Twisted Monkey. I think I read somewhere they've got a bouncy castle outside. A guided backstage tour around Watford Palace Theatre. Free makeovers in Boots. A £450 prize draw at John Lewis. Fabulous. Special curry club at the Langley Conferencing Suites. Great discounts at Watford's newest nail bar, Gloss Bar. And in-store workshops at Lush. I also know there's something going on at Watford Coliseum. There's tickets to be won for an event there. I also know that Watford Leisure Centre, or the Everyone Active Leisure Centre, is offering discounts on membership. So there's all sorts of things going on. There's face painting, free nightclub entry, live music. The snooker ball, snooker hall, Riley's Snooker Hall, I think is offering discounted memberships as well. So free swimming, free gym. There's so much going on. So be in Watford Town Centre this weekend and enjoy.
Okay, now a completely different contrast to that is the Apple Day in Chorley Wood.
Yes, so I had so many windows open for the Watford thing, so much going on there. This is Chorley Wood Apple Day. This is on the 1st of October, which is that tomorrow? It is, isn't it? Yeah, Chorley Wood Community Orchard is holding its 8th Apple Day on this Saturday from 11 till 3. Come along with friends and family to enjoy a celebration of all things apple. So obviously there's going to be some cider, there's some apple juice. You can help, or it says children can help, but I think it's adults too, compress apples into juice using their traditional crusher and press. It also says the adults can taste the cider there as well. There's a range of apple-based crafts for the children. Anyone can sample and buy unusual varieties of locally grown apples and juice. And there's lots of delicious homemade cakes, biscuits, jams, jellies and chutney made by their local volunteers. They have an infamous-sounding barbecue serving delicious pork and apple sausages made to order for us by the local butcher, J&J May. So with a choice of homemade plum or apple chutney, of course. All the details online. Have a look at the threerivers.gov.uk website and search for Chorley Wood Apple Day, and you'll find all the details there. But that's tomorrow, 11 till 3.
Okay, and this evening, talking about things to do, we'll talk about yellow comedy a bit later. Is it DJ Wayne or not?
Yes, it is. I think it is anyway. It says DJ Wayne, and in brackets it says other. Is it the other DJ Wayne? I don't know. Is there more than one? I don't know. I'm confused. Have to go along to find out, I guess. This is tonight. DJ Wayne playing 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and more. Playing the oldies. It will make you dance and sing till you can't dance and sing no more. Great party disco night, 9 till 1. Now, this is free entry before 9:30. £3 from 9:30 till 1. And that's tonight at the Horns.
Or it could be the incredibly cheesy pop.
Yes.
Bobby Sam Grant and his FTSE Disco.
Absolutely, yes. Yes, this is a I couldn't get my name around, head around the name of this. Welcome, Debutante Grant, FTSE Disco. And then in brackets also got comedy. So I don't know. I think you have to be there to believe it, perhaps. But yes, FTSE Disco playing his usual mix of 60s, 70s, 80s, soul, indie, ska, pop and rock with classic cheese. So
going to be Wayne or Grant.
Yeah, sounds like a hoot, doesn't it? Again, free before 9:30, £3 thereafter. That's tonight, 9 to 1.
Tomorrow evening at the Horns, it's Memphis Stone and the Elevators.
Absolutely. Bit of mod covers, a 10-piece band at the Horns. Put your dancing shoes on, get down to the classic sounds of Motown, Northern Soul, 60s Soul. Energetic 8-piece band, Memphis Stone at the Elevators, will have you dancing till you drop. And then they'll get you up and make you do it all over again. Get my teeth in. This is tomorrow evening. This is free. And it's from 9 in the evening till 1 at the Horns.
Okay, and on Sunday there's a gig still on, although another one is cancelled, but the one that's still on is Missing Cat.
Yeah, I thought this was an advert to start with. There was no cat pictures there. So, no, it's the name of the band, Missing Cat. Rock covers, 6-piece, at the Horns, mostly grey in colour, mature in age, but still able to stay up all night playing a selection of rock, pop, funk, soul and good old rock and roll. Based in and around Hertfordshire, Missing Cat have performed and headlined at the annual Bunce Festival, a live show guaranteed to get you on your feet. 4 till 7 in the evening, and this is on Sunday at Horns, and it's free.
Okay, and the Groovy Boys gig that was supposed to take place between 8 and 10:30 on Sunday has been cancelled.
Indeed, yeah. I'm not going to advertise it, because it's not happening.
So I'm just letting everyone know it's cancelled.
Indeed.
Now, Colosseum have still got tickets for tonight's performance by Roy Chubby Brown.
Indeed, yes, you'll have to get a move on and snatch up those last tickets. As you say, it's Roy Chubby Brown, that's tonight, Watford Coliseum, starts at 7:30. Tickets priced £21.50. There are some concessions, group savings, so have a look online. That's watfordcoliseum.co.uk.
Okay, and Jane McDonald is appearing tomorrow, and again, there are a few tickets left.
Indeed, yes, as you say, Jane McDonald's tomorrow night. She starts at 7:30 in the evening. Ticket pricing is £32 or £37. As you say, there's probably a few left. In the latter stages of advertising, there's usually a few seats dotted around, so you'll have to get in there quick to get on down there tomorrow night.
Okay. Now, the Watford Palace Theatre, they are starting a long run of the play Arms and the Man.
Indeed, yes. I've given some details about this over the last couple of weeks, so I won't go into the whole story, but it's basically billed as comedy, romance and chocolates. Arms of the Man, this starts, as you rightly say, tonight. It starts at 7:30 tonight. It runs until the 22nd of October. There's lots of chances to see this. There's matinees on odd days, including Saturdays. There are preview showings, which are £15. Normal ticket pricing ranges from £12.50 concessions up to £24.50, depending on when you sit and when you go. Have a look on the Watford Palace Theatre website. That's Arms of the Man, which starts tonight.
Okay, and the Palace Theatre on Sunday afternoon have another one of these delayed live performances, but this time from the Royal Opera House.
Indeed, yeah, this is Norma. Antonio Papano conducts an all-star cast in a new production of Bellini's operatic masterpiece. Must admit, I didn't know very much about this one. It's an intriguing story. which I will briefly tell you about. It's a backdrop of war driven by the extremes of fanatically religious society, modern edge to a timeless tale of love, rivalry and betrayal. So there's going to be some dramatic stuff going on. This is on Sunday. It's at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, £15, and there are no concessions. That's Norma, and it's delayed live from Royal Opera House.
Okay, and Sunday evening they're showing a play, again, a delayed live performance, but this time from the National Theatre.
Yes, this is The Deep Blue Sea. Helen McCrory, one of my favourite actresses. If you've ever seen Peaky Blinders, you'll know why. Helen McCrory returns to the National Theatre in Terence Rattigan's devastating masterpiece, playing one of the greatest female roles in contemporary drama. Tom Burke, from War and Peace and the Musketeers, another favourite of mine, also appears in Kerry Cracknell's critically acclaimed new production, A Flat in Ladbroke Grove, West London, 1952, when Hester Collier is found by her neighbours in the aftermath of a failed suicide attempt, the story of her tempestuous affair with a former RAF pilot and the breakdown of her marriage to a High Court judge begins to emerge. With it comes a portrait of need, loneliness and long repressed passion. Behind the fragile veneer of post-war civility burns a brutal sense of loss and longing. Again, another dramatic performance by the sound of it, and definitely well worth seeing. Delayed live from the National Theatre, The Deep Blue Sea, is on Sunday, 2nd October, 7 o'clock in the evening, £15.
Okay, that's great. Moving on, slight diversion. Watford and Bushey Art Society are meeting on Tuesday.
Yes, there's an event here, isn't there? This is the Portrait in Oils with a live sitter demonstration by John Whittle. Whittle. I'll say it again, Whittle. 4th of October, 7:30 till 9:30 in the evening, and this is at Tennant Hall, Watford Grammar School for Girls, Ladies Close, Watford. Watford Bushey Art Society. You say they're local meetings, regular meetings rather there, are they?
They are. It's always the first Tuesday of the month.
Cool. Excellent. Well, this is a special one that they're doing. Everyone's invited. Do go along and see what Portrait in Oils with a live sitter is all about.
Okay. And finally, Yellow Comedy got a double header this weekend.
Indeed, yes, we should be going tonight. This is at LJ's Cafe, coffee shop cafe tonight. This is just outside, or just opposite rather, Bushey Station. We've got headliner AJ Roberts. We also got Sven Cockerell, Pauline, Peter Merritt, Johnny Murph, Mike Sheldon, Mango Stone. Sorry, it made me laugh. And of course, fabulous MC Andrew Carberry. We shall be there when the doors open at 7:30 this evening. Comedy starts at 8. Free to get in, not always free to get out. Tomorrow night, they're doing the Pump House, just down the road, in fact, from where they are tonight. Headliner will be Sean Sellers. Also appearing are Trevor Bickles, Dave Block, Bentley Browning, Eileen Harris, Katie Lane, Dave J. Long, and of course MC extraordinaire Andrew Harbury. Again, starts at 7:30. Doors open around 7:30, starts at 8. Take some loose change or some notes with you, just in case there's a bucket on the way out.
Or a £5 note, or a tenner.
Yes, bit of plastic. £5 notes, yes.
Yes, exactly. I mean, Sean Sellers is appearing tomorrow night. I've seen him before at when he headlined at Reason, and he was very, very funny and definitely well worth seeing. He's a comedian who's definitely on the up. I don't remember or recall seeing AJ Roberts, so I can't comment on him, but both evenings have a good variety of supporting acts, many of whom I've seen before, and can thoroughly recommend.
Brilliant. Look forward to it.
Okay. Now, Link for Growth next week. We didn't, at the start of the show, have time to talk about what had happened last week, but Link for Growth this week. Tomorrow, Chris is at Barracuda's, which is next to Watford Market, between 10 and 11:30 for a Link for Coffee. As I said, as I usually say on these occasions, it is a good occasion to go along, chat to Chris, and find out more about what Link for Growth is and how it tries to build community in the area. It's definitely an organisation that is has many strands to it, and there's all sorts of ways in which you can become involved. On on Monday evening, Chris can get yet more lemon drizzle by going to Link for Coffee or Coffee Afternoon at the kitchen in Croxley between 5:30 and 7 o'clock in the evening. This is a usually a fairly full event, and it's usually a packed event, and it's well supported. And that's hosted by Linda Anderson down at the kitchen in Croxley. And by the way, Linda makes fabulous cakes. Following on from the kitchen Croxley coffee in the evening, there's the National Link for Growth Mingle, which is a national Twitter meetup that happens until 9 o'clock on the first Monday of every month. So again, you just join in, type in hashtag L4G mingle, and you will automatically connect up with the other people taking part. And it's a good way to meet people and to put out appeals for information, or if you're looking for new contacts in a certain area, because it does take place on a national level. It's the first ever Link for Drinks, now that's Langley at Royal Oak, as we talked about earlier with Rachel, and that starts at 7:30 on the 4th of October, and probably go on to the 10 or so. Then on Wednesday, Regis in Watford on Clarendon Road host a Link for Growth coffee morning between 10 and 11:30. And on Thursday, Perk Coffee Shop in Carpenters Park are hosting a Link for Coffee morning between 9:30 and 11. Perk, by the way, hosted a very good Yellow Comedy evening the other week, the first one, and Yellow Comedy is delighted to be going back there, I know this, in November. So that will be something to look forward to. As indeed is this restaurant review from Catherine, because I know that's a really good one this week. Catherine.
Absolutely. Okay, so we had a lovely evening at the Grove last Friday evening, which was a Christmas present, in fact, that was given to us last Christmas. We thought we better jolly well get on and use it before we get to this Christmas. So first thing I would say is they do give vouchers. That's a nice idea. The Glass House is one of three restaurants at the Grove. It's the buffet restaurant. The fine dining is Colette, very expensive. You need a very big wallet to go there. And the other restaurant is the Stables, which is sort of gastro bistro pub, very informal dining, but really, really lovely in there as well. The Glass House actually has a terrace that opens out in the summer, so you can actually sit outside if you want to as well. Lovely setting inside, lots of different table arrangements for large and small groups. As I say, it's a buffet, so you can go literally around the world. I'm just calling up the sample menu here. So you've got all sorts of salads, you can have little dips and little taster things from all around the world, including some tapas selections, charcuterie. There's also lots of different seafoods that you can have, some which is hot, some which is cold. I had a lovely little prawn salad pot in a dinky little pot. It was really, really sweet. There's an Asian selection, a live wok station. So choose your ingredients, your bits and pieces, and they'll cook it in front of you. Main courses include what we had, which was actually the carvery selection, with beef to die for. It was amazing. When we spoke to the waiter afterwards to pass on our compliments to the chef, he actually just dropped into conversation that the beef supplier they have is the same that the Queen uses. So there we go. We have a royal warrant on the beef at the Grove. But there's all sorts of things, obviously. Pasta, there's fish, there's a whole selection of vegetables as well. There's a beautiful dessert section. If you like dinky little chocolate desserts, then that's the place to be. There's all sorts of things to choose from, including, obviously, some fresh fruit salad and... No, I think that was the only healthy option, actually, fresh fruit salad. There's also the international cheese selection, which again goes around the world with all the different bits and pieces that go with it as well. It's a nice quince paste that goes with it, and your biscuits and your celery sticks to boot. Lovely wine selection. The wine menu is extensive, but obviously they do beers and everything as well. It was a lovely experience. Very, very nice waiters, very nice staff. You can sit in the bar beforehand, choose your cocktails beforehand, and then be shown through through to your table and say they cater for large groups. We were sat next to a very large group, in fact, but they left soon enough, and that was good. But yeah, I would recommend the Glass House. It's a lovely place to go. They open for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. There's obviously different things to suit different purses on the menu. There are set menus as well. But yeah, it's a lovely experience. Very nice. Give it a go.
Okay, well, glad it was such a good experience for you, especially since it was a gift. And thank you for that. And we look forward to your review next week. Hopefully, you're going somewhere equally.
No, we're probably going to the pub down the road this week. We've got the money.
Right, okay. Well, no doubt we'll hear about your trip down the pub or whatever it is next week in the restaurant with you. In the meantime, if you do have any comments or thoughts on the programme or items you want us to cover, then please get in touch with us via Twitter at L4G SW Herts. That's at L4G SW Herts. And Catherine and I, and on behalf of Neil and Chris, would like to say thank you for watching, and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
Ta-da! Have a good week.